Welcome to this special update. First, we're going to look at the seismic activity that we had since the previous update, the 3rd of December. And here on the SGI graph, we see that we had three lunar peaks, as I explained in the previous update, with Venus, the Sun, full moon, and with Mars. And we see some seismic response there in the mid to high 5 magnitude range, 4 in total, peaking 5.8 in southern Xinjiang, China. And then within two days of the Mars alignment, the Moon-Mars alignment, we see on the 7th magnitude 6.8 in southern Yukon territory, Canada, and also 5.6 at Vanuatu, 5.6 at the Kuril Islands, and another aftershock 5.8 in Canada. So we have stronger earthquakes, a tight clustering of stronger earthquakes in various locations, and that's very typical for specific geometry in the solar system, which causes increased tidal forcing, and that's directly responsible for this typical temporal clustering, strong earthquakes in various locations on the planet. That's the seismic activity that we had so far. This morning we have the first planetary conjunction with Venus, and until the 12th we have 6 planetary conjunctions, and we go into that because this is very interesting geometry, as we will see. On the 11th, the great conjunction Sun-Saturn-Neptune will be exact. And this grand conjunction with Sun-Saturn-Neptune repeats itself every 36 years approximately. So the last time was in 1989. Now this time, like I said, we have 6 planetary conjunctions in total, but 4 of them are directly caused by a quadruple conjunction, because Mercury, as we see here in front of the Sun, is actually joining the grand conjunction here. And that's noteworthy. It doesn't mean that we're going to have a very large earthquake directly, no. That very much depends on the position of the Earth. It's on the left side here. And it also depends on the positions of the other planets, and also the Moon, of course. And the Moon here is lining up with Saturn and Neptune. There can be stronger seismic activity as a result, as I explained in the previous update. But I was curious about this specific geometry because 36 years ago, when the Grand Conjunction also happened, the positions of the other planets are very different. They were very different. So I expected Mercury to be in a very different position as well. But that was not the case. We see Mercury again on the other side of the Sun, again forming a quadruple conjunction with the Sun, Saturn, and Neptune. Also pretty tight, because it was from 15 to 18 July 1989 that this grand conjunction, including Mercury, occurred. And that raised the question, what is this with Mercury? Because if that happens, there is probably orbital resonance going on between this grand conjunction and Mercury. So I went further back in time and I looked at 1953. And what do we see again? The grand conjunction Sun, Saturn, Neptune is kissed by Mercury again on the other side of the Sun. And that was a reason for me to directly investigate this specific quadruple conjunction, because over multiple decades, multiple 36-year cycles of the grand conjunction, Mercury at the same place, that is special. So I researched it thoroughly. Here in 1953, the quadruple conjunction was extremely tight, all happening on the 18th of February 1953. And we can go back to 1917, and there we see that Mercury is actually quite a bit off. So that was a confirmation that it is not all the time. It doesn't happen with every 36-year cycle. But apparently we are in a phenomenon here, a period of this specific phenomenon that Mercury lines up with the Grand Conjunction several times, starting in 1953. And if we look at the future, the next Grand Conjunction will be around May-June 2061. And again, we see Mercury on the other side of the Sun, but it is a little bit off, a couple of days. So again, there it is fading. So apparently, from 1953 to 2025, approximately, it is a period of roughly 70 years, there is a very tight resonance with Mercury and the Grand Conjunction. But it doesn't stay. It is just very stable across these decades. So I looked at when it started and when it faded. And in this table here, which you can also look up on the website, I have an article about this, a bit technical, but if you're interested in the specific geometry, you can look up the article on the website. I will put a link in the description box. In this table here, we see that it started after 1917 because Mercury was really off there. But after 1917, this quadruple pattern turned on dramatically, being extremely exact in 1953. And then also in 1989, with only 5 minutes, extremely close, 2025, second peak, still spectacular, with only 9.6 minutes difference that Mercury is away from the Grand Conjunction. And then in 2061, it's 35 minutes. And there we see that this phenomenon actually fades. And then in 2096, we already are at 1 degree, but still pretty close. So over a period of what, 150 years, we see an extremely close pattern, a quadruple pattern with Mercury, Sun, Saturn, and Neptune. If we do the calculations, again, you can look it up in the article on the website if you're interested. We come to the following conclusion. It's very interesting. The exact same pattern repeats itself after 60,000 years. And that's the time for the phase to drift a full 360 degrees. That's a full circle. And the pattern then repeats itself exactly in the same way. This is close to 60,000 years. Now, we have different configurations. If you look at the quadruple conjunction that we have in a couple of days, we have this specific geometry with Mercury on one side of the Sun and then the Grand Conjunction. But we also have oppositions like Mercury on the other side or Saturn on the other side, and that's the grand opposition. That's Saturn, Sun, Neptune, and then Mercury can be on either side of the Sun. That will also cause a sequence of quadruple patterns, and that will be in 2150, from 2150 to 2222. And you can see that again on this table here. And any combination of this quadruple conjunction repeats itself in a sequence roughly every 800 years, 700 to 900 years. But the entire sequence repeats itself after a full circle, and that is 60,000 years. So we really live in a very interesting time that we have this unique quadruple pattern of Mercury, Sun, Saturn and Neptune in a very tight sequence from 1953 to 2025, extremely exact. And we are experiencing the last very exact quadruple conjunction, which will not repeat itself exactly in the same way in another 60,000 years. You will only find this specific geometry if you do heliocentric observation, of course. Most astrologers and astronomers as well, they primarily do geocentric observations. That is, we look from the Earth, where the planets are and where the Moon is. And we won't see this specific geometry like Mercury, Sun, Saturn and Neptune. This is very important. If we limit ourselves to geocentric observations, we miss the most significant geometry in the solar system. It requires a multiple centric observations like heliocentric and also Mars or Venus or Mercury centric observations to see what is going on in the solar system. Now, to demonstrate that this is significant in relationship to larger earthquakes, I will look at the most obvious example. That is the largest earthquake on the record in 1960, magnitude 9.5 in Chile. If you look at the entire solar system, we see from a heliocentric observation that Mercury was in an alignment with the Sun and Jupiter. We see that Venus was in alignment with the Sun and Neptune. And if we do a Mars-centric observation or Mercury-centric observation, we see that Mars was in an alignment with Mercury and Uranus. And that all converged on the 20th and the 21st of May 1960. And on top of that, the Moon made an alignment here at a conjunction with Mars, while Mars was in an alignment with Mercury and Uranus. Now, if you do only a geocentric observation, like astrologers do with horoscopes, you will miss these alignments. And the only thing that you will basically see is that the Moon aligns with Mars around the time of the earthquake. But there's a lot more going on in the solar system. And to understand this, we have tidal forces. primarily from the moon, but also from the planets. And this, the tidal forcing that we experience fluctuates. It's stronger and then weaker and stronger and weaker. And this fluctuation of the tidal force, that is caused by the motion of the moon, but also the planets. It fluctuates with the motion, the movement of the planets and the moon. This is very, and that's why I always look at the geometry of the between the planets and the moon from any angle, any multicentric points of view. In 1964, another example, magnitude 9.2 in Alaska, and again we see that the moon aligned with Mars, and also it was the time of full moon, and that's what we can observe from a geocentric point of view. But at the same time, what we would miss, even with a heliocentric observation, is that Mars, Mercury, Venus, and Uranus aligned in a very tight quadruple conjunction here. Do a Mars-centric observation or Mercury-Venus-centric observation, and you will see that. So I emphasize how important it is to do multicentric observations. Basically, if you have a simulation software like Solar System Scope, you do a view on the north pole of the solar system, and you can actually see that more or less how planets are in conjunctions. This is very significant. So on the 11th, 12th of December, we're going to have this unique Mercury, Sun, Saturn, Neptune quadruple conjunction, which is part of a sequence that started in 1953. And it's very unique. These are very large cosmic cycles that we're talking about here. And it just tells us that, I mean, if we have cycles, we have cycles intertwining, we have cycles converging, and that also results in this fluctuation of the tidal forces. So we may actually be dealing with cycles that we don't know about because they are so huge in time. But even 60,000 years is a tiny fraction on a cosmic scale and also on a geological scale. But for us humans, it is huge. So it is very important to be aware of cycles in the universe and also the cycles between the planets. In this particular case, this sequence of quadruple conjunctions occurs because in roughly 36 years that the grand conjunction occurs each time, Mercury completes almost exactly 149 orbits around the Sun. Almost. But there are variations because of eccentricity, Mercury's orbit, but also Neptune's orbit. There are perturbations. There are several factors why it is not exactly 149 orbits of Mercury in these 36 years. But it's close. But it also drifts away. And this is the coming and going of cycles, of tidal forcing. The moon is very much involved. So in the coming time frame, from 8 to 12 December, we're going to have a convergence of planetary conjunctions, as I explained in the previous update. And yes, with the lunar geometry in particular, around the time of this lunar geometry with Saturn and Neptune, there can be an obvious seismic response, there can be a larger earthquake. It depends on the stress levels in Earth's crust, because Earth also has its own geological processes. It's not just the planets and the tidal forcing, it's also the movement of the tectonic plates on Earth, that's Earth's own geological process. But when a specific fault section has reached the tipping point, then the tidal forces become extremely significant because the timing of an earthquake is determined by a peak of tidal forcing. And that's why we look at the planets and the moon. So be on extra alert in the coming days. There can be an obvious seismic response, not necessarily. There is no statistic that tell us that with this grand conjunction we always have a big earthquake. It doesn't work like that. That's also because the stress levels in Earth's crust are different every time. So 36 years ago, the stress distribution across the planet was completely different. We had big quakes in 2004, 2010, and 2011, and now this year another 8.8. So the stress distribution, the tectonic stress distribution is very different this time. And it is also a major factor and is decisive. It depends on the stress levels in Earth's crust, whether or not we're going to have a big quake, and actually what the seismic response is going to be. So this is the update for now. Stay safe, everyone, and until next time.